much for coming out tonight. I want to thank Ingrid, who's online, I believe, somewhere, or getting closer if she can get through the traffic in Denver. Ingrid was my undergrad. Can you imagine, like, to have the communication specialist from here walk into your environmental communication class? I was like, okay, what are you going to do? She's like, this is what I'm doing. And so we've kept in touch, obviously, because we had a few things in common. So I'm grateful for the invitation. I want to start off, as we often do at the university, to acknowledge that we're on the lands of the Cheyenne, Ute, and Arapaho peoples. I had grand ambitions like 2 weeks ago when the semester was ending to make a water acknowledgement because I've never seen one before for Boulder. If any of you have seen a water acknowledgement, I'd love for you to email one to me, but if not, that's now one of my new missions because we should have that for here because we're so land centric, except for in places like this, which give me the opportunity to think about water. Obviously we need to do more than acknowledgements. I do a lot of my research in solidarity with and amplifying Indigenous theorists and communities. And I hope that you do too. How are we doing on a sound check for, okay, good. Just making sure there's more people online than I think actually in person. So I also wanna thank people for showing up. I've shown this slide at the beginning of every talk I've given since 2019. Because, well, we're not over the pandemic and here I am wearing a mask again because we're at medium levels. Sometimes we feel fear, sometimes we feel like we're learning, sometimes we're ready to go out and do action, and some hours I feel all the feelings all at once. I know a lot of us have felt with a lot of loss. Every time we take a trip, we're like constantly doing COVID tests in my house, and you know they're all made of plastic, and then the guilt piles up, and then all the other things. And so I just want to thank people for being here online, or being here in person, however you can show up for this issue, because with all the crises in the world, it's really an honor that anyone would want to talk about any of this at all. So I'm gonna actually see if I can move this bar down, but I might not be able to. So hopefully it won't cut anything off. This evening, I do wanna talk to you about plastics, how we can get people to care more about oceans, marine life. But first, it's gonna be a little depressing for the first third, as was anticipated already by audience members. But honestly, it's not as depressing as most of my talks, because usually I talk about toxic pollution and environmental racism, and that's really a cocktail party killer. So I feel like with plastics, at least like everyone can relate to it. So even though I know a lot of you online and here in person probably know a good deal about plastics, I just wanna make sure we're covering our basis with just how bad it's gotten. More and more testimonies of people firsthand going underwater and seeing plastic in all sorts of places where you didn't see plastic before. So plastics have received attention in part because they've expanded globally like no other commodity on the planet. In 1950, the industry, the plastics industry, created 1.5 million metric tons of plastics. By 1976, the number rose to 50 million metric tons. Then the pace picked up, doubling in a little over a decade by 1989. That number doubled again by 2002 when the world produced 200 million metric tons, and we crossed the threshold of 300 million metric tons of plastic back in 2014. This includes a lot of types of plastics. I hope that S is coming through my mask. As Max Lebron writes in their book, Pollution is Colonialism, the term plastic refers to many types of polymers, many, many different associated industrial chemicals. Plastic in the singular misses that there's central range and diversity to plastic activism, plastic science, plastic policy, and other plastic relations. So it's important to think about plastics in general, which I'll start off with, and then to explore some specifics. Tonight, I'm gonna actually focus on one specific, and that is single-use plastic straws. To date, the invention of straws, most people trace back when they were made of grass by the Sumerians of Mesopotamia back in 3000 BC, and they used them to drink beer. So again, it doesn't always start off bad, but then ends up somewhere else. It's not till 1888 that someone in the US, of course, patented it because they started making them out of paper. And then in the 1930s, the first bendable plastic straw was invented and patented by Joseph B. Friedman because sitting in his brother's soda fountain parlor, for the younger folks in the audience, that's like when you would go into like a drugstore. Okay, people are nodding at me, that looks much younger. Sometimes they don't know. I talk about, you know, telephones and I'm like, do you know they used to be attached to walls? Okay, so it was in a fountain parlor shop where people would get milkshakes. And then he looked over at his daughter and she was struggling drinking her milkshake with a straw. And he realized I should make something for her to make it easier. What a great dad, right? So it's not a bad story when it begins. And then when he goes to mass market it, he decides to mass market it to hospitals. And so when he mass markets it, he calls it the flex straw, and not only used for children, but as an adaptive technology. So the success of this ad campaign is why a lot of people associate plastic straws with disability and universal design. Today, best estimates are that plastic straws alone constitute 0.025% of ocean plastic. And that might not sound a lot, but that's of 13 million. So that means we have 325,000 tons of plastic waste per year in the ocean alone, just from straws. And while the Ocean Conservancy estimates that most single-use straws are used for about 20 minutes before we throw them away, they don't magically disappear. So according to the WWF, a plastic straw itself lasts 200 years. After 200 years, it just breaks down into bits and then ends up everywhere, right? Which is those of you that already work on microplastics know that very well. So given the impact of straws alone, I'm sure many of you have heard the next frightening headline. If we don't change our current direction, the World Economic Forum estimates more than tripling current amounts once again by 2050, which would lead us to a one-to-one ratio of plastics to fish in the ocean by waste. Have most people, I'm just kind of gauging, how many plastic heads do I already have in the house that are like, yeah, we got this. Like half of you. Okay, this is good to know. So due to the ubiquity, plastics have become part of what Lauren Berlant calls the intimate public sphere. And what we mean by that is that our modes of attachment to plastic can feel very personal, like objects we put in our mouth, like our toothbrushes, and connected to our shared lives, because we dispose of them in trash cans or recycling bins and public spaces. Admittedly, some plastics are life-saving, so I always feel like this is important to say. My mom passed away this fall. The whole hospital was filled with plastic. There's IV tubes, there's scrubbers for people's mouths, there's all sorts of plastic we use. I typed this talk on plastics. I'm using plastics in my contacts and my eyeballs. I'm not someone who thinks that you can 100% get away from plastics in your life. So that's not what we're talking about today. What we're talking about today is the massive amount of single-use plastic that is used very quickly by most people. And by most people, not all people will return to that, is unnecessary. So why do we suddenly start putting our peppers in plastic? Why is there that stupid film of plastic on pasta boxes? I know I'm Italian-American, but they really annoy me. Because you have to rip out that sheet of plastic in order to recycle the rest of the cardboard. And I'm like, there's no other product like that. Like, why is it pasta that people mistrust? That they're like, I have to have a window to my pasta, or I'm not going to believe the shape or the picture on the box. Everything else at the store, I believe. It's just the pasta that's tripping us up. Those are the plastics that annoy me. Those are the plastics I want to talk about tonight. Those are the plastics that I'm pretty sure we could live without, especially if we're talking about a one-to-one ratio to fish to plastics, right? Can we please start with these single-use plastics? Nevertheless, they can feel like private choices. A lot of people will like talk to me and come up to me and then feel they need to confess. So I already confessed to you. I'm surrounded by plastic all the time, and I'm not here to make you feel bad about that. I think that's how most of us are. I'm here to talk about a specific type of plastic that's kind of gotten out of hand and ways that we might push back on that. And in case I haven't created a sense of urgency in you yet, plastics impact human rights at every stage, not just at disposal. Consider how plastic pollution permeates everything from the cellular level to the atmospheric level. For public health, as the Just Transition Alliance emphasizes, plastics cause harm throughout their life cycle. So plastics involve the risky endeavor of extracting fossil fuels for production, off-gassing and leaching toxic chemicals into our body and the environment when we consume them. And then, of course, as we already talked about at the time of disposable, it leaches into the atmosphere. In some places like Bangladesh, the reason why the first plastic ban was passed in the world in Bangladesh is because they were having floods that they attribute to be worse due to climate change. And the plastic bags in the streets were blocking the drainage in their streets, and people literally drowned. So there's a way in the US where plastic bans are being pitched as this like very privileged topic, but literally the people who've been pushing plastic bans much longer than they've been advocated for in the US are talking about life and death situations with plastics. And certainly if we think of marine life, that is the situation. This year, of course, scientists also confirmed that all of us have microplastics in our lungs and in our blood. So all of us are becoming more plastic, so to speak, even if we don't know what that entails. So plastics are contributing also then to the climate emergency. If plastic were a country, Judith Eng says from Beyond Plastics, it would be the world's fifth largest greenhouse gas emitter, beating out China, all but China, the US, India, and Russia. Estimated to become 20% of the global oil consumption by 2050, plastics. The multinational corporations that produce them are looking to plastics to help compensate for decrease global demand for oil and gas and coal. So as the world is transitioning away from fossil fuels, even though these products have already benefited from great exponential growth, they're actually ramping up for new campaigns to push them even more to make up for their bottom line. So we can still use fossil fuels towards plastics, even if we're not using their energy source. So plastics contribution towards climate emergency is cause for alarm. I hope everyone here agrees with that. As scientists assess, the Earth's climate has already begun to wobble or flicker as we head towards tipping points and critical transitions. With increased public concern over plastics, many have decided to focus on single use. So single use in the English language refers to one-time consumption since at least the 1200s. It's not a new idea, but it means that you use it once, usually briefly, before disposal, and then it's in the world. We only have recycled, it used to be up to last year, people estimated 9% of all plastics ever made were recycled. Now we're down to 6% was the last report this month. We've only recycled ever in the history of plastics, 6% of them. So even though we've been raised since elementary school to believe we got to sort all of our recyclables and plastics are a really important one to put aside, we're not actually following through that. So the US began throwaway in everyday language for something that was meant to be discarded relatively quickly. And some in the plastics industry promoted this throwaway culture to increase their profits. Single-use plastics epitomize throwaway culture, which is a shift in a broader structure of feeling from the world going from valuing right now something like novelty or disposability, as opposed to, for example, if we valued endurance or repairability or sentimentality, reasons why we might stay attached to things and not get rid of them so quickly. In 2018, the Collins Dictionary declared single-use the word of the year. Given a fourfold increase in usage in this word since 2018, I really am going to move that bar because it's probably bothering the people that aren't in the room with us. Can I do that? Or can you do that? Can you drag that? Oh, okay. Oh, so it's not showing up for them. Okay, great. No, don't worry about these folks here because they get to, we're talking in the room, but I worry for them because I know it's a different type of experience online. So I'm interested in when it became word of the year because at 2018, they announced it was this because there was a fourfold increase in the usage of the word single use since 2013. So what I've been studying, what I'm interested is in this 5-year period of time when we had this rapid increase of this interest in single use plastic. As someone who's long studied the environment, I'm always interested when we actually move people to care about something different. And how did that happen? And can we do it again with other issues such as climate, right? And so what I'm interested in is what causes this attention and how can we do something about it in the future? And I promise the last point of background before we get to the fun videos, which seems important to emphasize, is that while we're all impacted by and contribute to the plastics and climate crises, we are not all impacted equally. So one of the most important environmental policy decisions to transform global plastic waste trade happened in 2017. China passed a policy, it's called the National Sword Policy. And in 2017, China said, we're not gonna take any imported plastic waste anymore. At that point in time, China was accepting 70% of our plastic recycling. 70% of everything we were creating up to 2017, they were taking in. And in 2017, they decided to stop taking it. This shifts everything globally. This shifts everyone globally in terms of who's gonna take plastic waste, who's not, and what does that mean for US governments who suddenly are thinking, well, do we need to keep them on site? And what does it mean if we have to keep the plastics in our own country? One regulatory response, of course, was just to send it to other countries. So I want to quote one of my favorite journalists, Sharon Lerner, on the export of plastic waste to give you a sense of the scale of exportation. In 2019, American exporters shipped almost 1.5 billion pounds of plastic waste to 95 countries. And I think most of these are going to be ones some of you have traveled to. Malaysia received more than 133 million pounds from the US alone. Thailand got about 60 million pounds. Mexico got 81 million pounds. Ghana, Uganda, Tanzania, South Africa, Ethiopia, Senegal, and Kenya were among the African countries that received American plastic garbage after the National Sword Policy, most of which was the hardest recycled plastic and the least valued plastic. Jamaica also receives American plastic waste more than 100,000 pounds a year. And that's just what's in the official record. That's just what's being reported, right? That doesn't have anything to do with the legal plastics trade. So for those keeping track, plastics are bad for the earth, they're bad for marine life, they're bad for the planet, they're bad for climate, and they're exacerbating inequalities among humans. With that background in mind, I wanna turn to what we can do to make things better. By show of hands, how many of you have done a beach cleanup or a park cleanup in your lifetime, either with a group or just picked up litter? Okay, I don't know about you people online, but the in-person people are shaming you because all of them, 100% of the hands went up. I've been doing them forever too. But this man does them more than anyone else I've ever heard of on the planet. He's a lawyer in Mumbai, India, Afroz Shah, who's been picking up litter from beaches since 2015 every weekend. And so up to this week, he's been doing cleanups for 370 weeks straight and going. So I'm like, this is a new aspirational goal. But Shah, clearly more dedicated to beach cleanups than most of us even, made his aspirations explicit in an interview. He says, quote, "Cleaning is one part, but not the solution. We're drowning in plastic. The bottle packets, the wrappers, packaging to preserve the food is what travels and lands in the ocean. You have to reduce garbage in this world and change the way our packaging is made. So it's about what you can do as a person and as a system," end quote. So linking his weekly practice of doing beach cleanups, which I am pro doing cleanups. I think they're an important thing. I think they're community building. I think if you love beaches, you gotta get rid of the waste somehow. But he's also calling for systemic change, right? He's one of the many global anti-plastic waste advocates that refuse to bifurcate individual and institutional choices. So that all brings me up to my book, which will be published by University of California Press in 2023, I hope, called Beyond Straw Man. It's an attempt to move beyond everyone's hot take or straw man fallacies about plastics online, consider how we came to this conjuncture. So the book is following hashtag trends across the world about how plastics have become articulators of broader cultural crises, corporate greenwashing, carceral environmental politics, American exceptionalism, eco-ableism, climate fatalism, and censorship to care for intersectional climate justice, marine life conservation, disability justice, and human rights. Tonight, I'm just focusing on the one chapter. In tonight's talk, I want to focus on how to motivate people to care about marine life in the ocean, something I'm sure a lot of you know a lot about, which is why I'm really excited to be here with you and learn from you. Since COVID has muddled with our sense of time, or at least mine, I wanna share what was considered a cutting edge in what I think is a moving media campaign that launched before the campaign I wanna focus on to remind us of the tone of ocean advocacy way back in 2014, before the pandemic, before single use became word of the year, and before a female scientist pulled a straw out of a turtle's nose. So this was a very compelling campaign. I will start the video shift earlier in the future so you don't have to have that lag. And hopefully our sound is good. Conservation International. And they have a whole series. There's actually one on coral reefs. So I would recommend checking them all out. But they were a moment in time, yeah? It was a moment. Wow. Yeah. I think it's moving, and I think that the PSA has a lot going for it. First, I would say Harrison Ford was and probably still is a celebrity that can get popular attention. I look to faces in the room. Second, it's aesthetically engaging. Y'all are spoiled here at Ocean First, but not everyone knows how to make beautiful content. And it does make a difference. It really does make a difference if you can make beautiful content. And I think they achieved that. But third, for the communication nerds tuning in, and I know there are a couple of them online, it's a powerful example of what we would call prosopopoeia, or maybe you learn something like anthropomorphism or personification. And that's when you imitate the ethos or character of an agent chosen to be portrayed, right? So when writing or speaking as if one was non-human has long been relished by many of us eco-nerds as a powerful rhetorical trope and a powerful exercise. This PSA though reminds me of a marine biologist, Rachel Carson. And one of my favorite graduate students who's an ocean advocate didn't realize Rachel Carson was a marine biologist. So I hope everyone here knows. That's her roots, because people don't often talk about that. But her first book was The Sea Around Us. And she says, quote, "It is a curious situation that the sea from which life first arose should now be threatened by the activities of one form of that life. But the sea, though changed in a sinister way, will continue to exist. The threat is rather to life itself," end quote. So to me, Conservation International's message is not new, but I would argue it's emblematic of a taken for granted sentiment at the time of how we might convince people to feel the vastness of the ocean and to feel a sense of crisis or urgency to do something about it. But I would also say it has a few drawbacks. First, there's no clear action request. So I moved, but I don't know what to do at the end of it. Relatedly, as my students have told me over the years, because I love showing those films and seeing whose videos they want to see, I'm always like, oh, Lupita Nyong'o. And they're like, no, we want to hear like the old men, like Robert Redford and Harrison Ford. It surprises me. But I'm like, yay, middle-aged people and old people, we're going to keep persisting. So my students have told me that for them, it evokes a sense of guilt, right? They feel horrible. They feel scared sometimes, depending on the narrative. And then that makes them feel like they're too small to do anything about it, right? So they don't feel like a sense of agency at the end of it, even if they forget the fact they don't tell you what to do, but they don't even feel like they can do anything when they get to end it because it's so heavy, right? And while shaming corporations and large institutions can and has had political impacts, shaming individuals tends to be ineffective. And it tends to exacerbate inequalities. And that's a point I'm happy to revisit in the Q&A, because there's a difference between shaming a large corporation or a government that you think needs to change their policy and shaming someone that like you're sitting, you know, at a table with at a restaurant, yeah? Okay, so the year after that previous video was created, in December 2015, a new NGO was founded by entertainment executives, actor Adrian Grenier and film producer Lucy Sumner. The Lonely Whale Foundation's mission is, quote, striving to inspire empathy towards marine species and develop lifelong advocates for ocean health, end quote. Based in New York City, Lonely Whale describes itself as an incubator for courageous ideas that drive impactful market-based change. The Lonely Whale Foundation is a nonprofit that connects companies, policymakers, other NGOs, and influencers or celebrities to market goods and services that aim to reduce the use of single-use plastics. So in the shop, like you have the bracelets that are made of plastic waste, right? Or they're like cups that are made from those things, right? So how can we use other things or things that won't be just used once, right? The reach of their social media campaigns were related to the plastic bans in the United States sparked policy and changing the tide of public opinion about single-use plastics. Lonely Whale's initial dilemma is one I hope many in this room have probably considered, quote, end online. We cannot care unless we connect. The first and foremost necessity is to try to connect the ocean to our everyday experience. Initially, it was a very simple communications challenge and opportunity, they say. How do we get people to connect with the ocean, end quote. This desire to foster connection so profoundly shaped the NGO's founding that they branded themselves the Lonely Whale. So another show of hands, and I don't know if people can weigh in online. How many of you already know about 52 or the Lonely Whale? Oh, that's exciting. That surprises me. You will enjoy this. So for those unfamiliar, earlier in 2010, For those earlier in 2010, based on overwhelming evidence of the complexities of cetacean minds, societies, and cultures, an international organization of scientists signed a declaration of rights for cetaceans, calling for their right to life, liberty, and well-being. This has led to a broader international discussion of ethics and whale rights, especially as whale tourism has increased globally. And as a sign of their dignities, whales not only interact with close kin, including their close maternal kin, but they also frequently interact with more distantly related and unrelated whales. So basically, whales have been globally networking long before humans invented the internet or Snapchat. Yeah? The known complex networked communication of whales involving both intelligence and emotions is part of why it's been so striking that one appeared to use a unique frequency. That whale is known as the loneliest whale, or 52, because its song came in at 52. You do know. Yeah, I know some of you would know about this. Came in at 52 hertz, right? And so there was no other whale that was at that same sound level when they discovered it, yeah? And so the whale became known as the loneliest whale, 52, and journalist Andrew Rifkin wrote in the New York Times, the call, possibly a mating signal, suggests that 52 lives in total and undesired isolation, end quote. So in 2021, filmmaker Joshua Zeman created a documentary called The Loneliest Whale, Search for 52. And it's relevant to this talk because, not just because he was self-obsessed with Rifkin's story as he describes, but one of the executive producers is Adrian Grenier, who's the co-founder of The Loneliest Whale. Yeah? The film recalls not only how Zeman and others have been moved by this animal, but also a brief, very brief, bloody history of how whales were killed as a main source for energy in the 19th century. From overhunted to whales' beloved, I would argue, iconic status today, The film underscores the importance of listening to whale songs. Most of you could probably stream this online today. And I'm just gonna show the trailer because it covers some historical moments. I actually was starting to make slides of the recording and all these other things. And then I was like, I could just show them the trailer and that will be more fun anyway. So here's the trailer for the film.
When you look at the sea, you're looking at a vast mystery.
In 1992, the top secret program in the U.S. Navy discovered a mysterious sound in the Pacific at a frequency of 52 hertz. A solitary whale broadcasting at a frequency that no other whale could understand. When I heard this story, the hairs on my arm just stood up. Turns out, it wasn't just me.
Legend has it that 52 has been roaming the ocean for decades, entirely alone.
52 hertz has been nicknamed
the loneliest whale in the world.
It's an amazing tale. The idea that there's a species of whale making a sound that no one has ever heard before.
So I was going through some of our recordings, and we found it.
So it's still alive?
Yeah, it's out there.
One whale.
But it's a big ocean.
By the 1960s, almost all the large whales were gone. This all began to change after a young biologist started listening to the song of a humpback whale. It became a multi-platinum record.
The world realized they sing. It made people care. And when people care, they can change the world.
To find the 52 hertz whale, we have a bioacoustic team real-time listening. So when we hear the 52 hertz sound, we could say, let's go over and investigate.
The sounds of fin and blue whales could travel about 13,000 miles.
This is a long-range social network.
6 years ago, ship noise didn't exist. Today, when we think of all the shipping traffic, imagine you're a whale. It drowns out everything you could possibly be listening to. You should be going after all great mysteries like this. We are social beings. The greatest joy is actually in the connectivity with life.
They're going for it, isn't it?
After years of endless searching, after years of calling out, it's the uniqueness of 52's call just may lead us right to him.
It's so good. It really is. You would probably, we would make a couple tweaks to it, but otherwise it's an excellent film. Of course, the male scientist had a wife who was a female scientist who doesn't get credited at all in the film, but you know, these are the ways histories get written. So of course it took more than a music recording to change global attitudes about whales. And the work began before. In 1961, the World Wildlife Fund was established in part to save whales. Its founder, Sir Peter Scott, is often quoted as saying, quote, if we cannot save the whales from extinction, we have little hope of saving mankind and the life-supplying biosphere, end quote. In appeals such as this, save the whales often is articulated or linked to saving ourselves, whether ecologically or emotionally. Global attention to the loneliest whales suggests the ways feeling like one might die alone, unable to connect with, and therefore unable to be heard by anyone else, struck an international chord. The whale has inspired musical drama, songs, novels, and more. An irony of our times, then, is while we are surrounded by billions of people in person and a content flood online, as well as non-human kin living around us, a sense of loneliness remains globally felt among many in our species. And just because I'm very self-conscious because I teach college students, I just want them to know there are people under the age of 40 that care about this. Even BTS, the K-pop sensation, has a song about lonely whales. It's actually quite good. So it is something that's captured the imagination. This interests me because I'm always interested in like what is moving people? What are they connecting to? Why are they relating to it? Why do you have everything from K-pop to like scientists on a ship, you know, tracking sound waves, all interested in this one thing? That is what I think is really fascinating. So the Lonely Whale, the NGO, named after this lonely whale, it doesn't want me to click yet. I will keep going. There we go. Began with a desire to create connections between humans and oceans or marine life, but then it wanted to change behavior and shape policy. So to do that, Lonely Whale followed a theory of social change called nudges. Ideal nudges are not focused solely on individuals, such as the person I'm with ordered a vegan meal, so then I will too, that type of nudge or suggestion, but also how individual actions can lead to policy changes and concrete impacts, such as hotels inviting us not to have our sheets cleaned or towels cleaned every day. Yeah? Bill McKibben describes how individual actions can shape others as the importance of multiplication, not addition. Quote, putting up a clothesline is a fine idea. 1,016 pounds of carbon, remember. But if you join Project Laundry List to fight for the idea of clotheslines, you become, in essence, an Amway salesman for positive change, end quote. Since humans often resist change and especially direct messages about what we should or should not do, especially in the United States, we hate those messages, nudges are an attempt to show by example or invite others to make a change by removing barriers or making choices easier to follow. So why nudge people about straws? Lonely Whale claims straws are among the top 10 items found in beach cleanups and can do so much harm to seabirds, turtles, and other marine creatures. Indeed, in 2012, after over 500,000 volunteers participated in the international coastal cleanup of approximately 18,000 miles of coastline, the Ocean Conservancy listed the top 10 finds. The first by far was cigarettes. But after that was plastic food wrappers, plastic beverage bottles, plastic bags, plastic caps, cups. There's plastic in cigarettes too, in case that wasn't implied. Plastic utensils, plates and cups, plastic straws and stirrers, glass beverage bottles, metal beverage bottles, and paper bags. So Lonely Whale also states a commonly cited statistic by Milo Kress, some of you might have heard of the founder of Be Straw Free, that the US uses over 50 million plastic straws daily, which are too lightweight to be recycled in most places. So plastic straw bans are never touted by Lonely Whale as the end of plastic pollution, but what I'd call an impure step towards a more sustainable world, or what some call a gateway for changing plastic behaviors and relationships. Most of us might be more familiar with the idea of a gateway drug rather than a gateway plastic. So social scientists have studied, this is actually, it's a phenomenon called the gateway hypothesis since the 1970s, researching if there is sufficient evidence that early use of minor drugs like alcohol, tobacco, cannabis might lead to more addictive drugs later in life. Since the gateway model of behavior change research has expanded to other realms, it now also includes reproductive health, the research is in diet, exercise, and a whole host of other things. Research shows that facilitating a successful behavior change, however small, can help one imagine greater self-efficacy or agency to change behavior with higher impact choices. So if you can give someone something small and they can see that it has an impact, they're more likely to try to take on something bigger, right, on the positive side. Dune Ives, who also has a PhD in psychology and was co-founder of the Green Sports Alliance, explains Lonely Whale's choice to use straws as a gateway. That's why we chose the plastic straw. To us, it was the gateway plastic to the larger, more serious plastic pollution conversation. So the approach to translate the large crisis of plastics moved into single plastics, then moved into plastic straws. Ives further explains the campaign's intent as follows. Our hashtag Stop Sucking Social Media Challenge aims to make ocean plastic pollution problem relatable, because we've all used a straw at some point, participatory through a direct social media challenge, culturally relevant, a straw was featured in the most liked Instagram post of 2016, sorry, and strike an emotional chord, who wants to suck? So in Seattle, the American Chemistry Council had won a victory against a previously fought for 20-cent plastic bag ban fee in 2008. They spent $180,000 to gather enough signatures to put the issue on the ballot. And then the American Chemistry Council devoted another $1.4 million in Seattle to overturn the plastic bag fee, which was the most spent on any Seattle referendum to date. The industry campaign relied largely on scare tactics, falsely claiming that the fee would cost the average consumer an extra $300 a year. So when Seattle asked Lonely Whale to help them popularize a new policy to ban some single-use plastics again in 2017, straws were at the time perceived as less controversial than bags, and a compelling conversation started to nudge people towards understanding the issue of single-use plastics and reducing consumption. So here is the video that launched the concept in Seattle itself, even though that's not gonna be my focus today, I thought it might be a fun one to watch.
I suck.
I may not look like I suck, but I do.
Van Jones sucks.
I've been sucking on TV since I was 10.
Everywhere I could suck, I would suck.
I've sucked in over 90 countries.
Democrats, Republicans, independents, we all suck.
You know who else sucks? Kendrick Samson.
I'm Kendrick Samson, and I suck.
We suck together.
Sure, I've sucked, but Yuna sucks even more.
Yuna sucks.
And I suck.
And I suck.
And I suck. When someone tweets, I suck, I'm like, I know.
Statistically speaking, most of us suck. Most of us suck every day. Suck, suck, suck.
Suck. Today, you probably used one of these.
500 million plastic straws are used in this country every single day.
And many end up in the ocean, polluting water and killing sea life.
If we don't act now, by 2050, there will be more plastic in the ocean than fish.
You know, like you're snorkeling, you look down, and you don't see fish, you see plastic.
But there's something you can do about it.
I will stop sucking.
I will stop sucking.
We will all stop sucking.
We will all stop sucking.
If you do.
So very different tone than the first PSA that we saw, yes. The hashtag was the first sign that this campaign wasn't the same old doom and gloom. I interviewed Emmy Kane, who's also a CU Boulder alum, who was the digital marketing and media strategist at the time of this campaign. She's still with Lonely Whale, who shared, quote, having a hashtag like hashtag stop sucking was essentially kind of our secret sauce, because we were able to leverage in so many different moments to really kind of generate that buzz and that word of mouth. And I also think it was a huge reason why we had so much success with our influencers initially as well, because they thought it was funny and then they thought it was funny, end quote. One creative director shared the following about the Stop Sucking campaign's concept. No one needs to see another PSA with some celebrity asking to do something for a cause that they care about. We've become completely desensitized to that technique. But a celebrity being self-deprecating, poking fun at themselves and admitting maybe they're not so perfect, and also in fact they just suck like the rest of us, well, maybe that will get people to sit up and take notice. So Stop Sucking was born. To launch a broader Stop Sucking campaign, Lonely Whale also held a pop-up event at South by Southwest, and many stood in line to participate in that. I'd like to share one of their videos from this campaign from which I borrowed my talk title, The Ocean is Angry. And this is where we really get into the heart of how Lonely Whale is so different from where we were with ocean advocacy before. It's our last one, so.
They've all been great.
Oh, good. I'm like, I don't know, are people getting tired? We all lose our attention span in COVID. Nope. It's a little different, yeah? A little different than Harrison Ford telling us. Yeah, exactly. So as you can imagine, filled with celebrities, fun music, the chance to be slapped by an octopus, the campaign took off. People loved it. Circulating videos and still images across all major social media platforms with an astounding impact that illustrates how tuned in with the mood of the time Lonely Whale was. As I've emphasized before, there is a risk in articulating environmental politics to what's considered sexy. One easily can eclipse structural change with bright lights, loud noises, and big egos. Celebrity culture, therefore, can reify dominant norms of culture and greenwashing, including the focus on individual consumption rather than systemic change. But celebrity endorsement of a campaign, nevertheless, remains a classic tactic of making something newsworthy, connecting beyond the often overwhelming facts, as we had at the beginning of my talk. And Lonely Whale's campaign did take off. As the campaign gained success globally, more and more politicians and advocates reached out to Lonely Whale to ask how they could create similar campaigns. Lonely Whale then developed a free toolkit, which you can get at this URL at the top, and I can send it back out to people who want it. It's www.strawlessocean.org. And that has over 25 languages for this campaign. Each campaign is encouraged to vary to appeal to the specific location. So in Chile, for example, in the adapted version of Lonely Whale Sucker Punch PSA, they co-created it with the Chilean government, who featured a seal because that was more culturally relevant than an octopus, yeah? So super fun campaign that got adopted in a lot of ways. And then they gave out all this free content and worked with all these different governments and all these different organizations globally to help them adapt it to what they were doing. Despite the global popularity, there was backlash. I know, we have to go there for a moment. To Lonely Whale's success, of course. The plastic straw became an articulator of crisis in the 2018 US presidential election, and the initial batch of that guy's straws sold out. Democratic candidate Elizabeth Warren warned that plastic straws and burgers were a distraction from real climate politics, and Bernie's campaign made, of course, union-produced metal straws. Also interestingly, while behavioral scientists of public health tend to find evidence of gateway actions mattering, those who focus on environmental advocacy express reservations regarding this approach to change green behavior. For example, co-director of the Stanford Center of Ocean Solutions, Jim Lee, cautions, quote, "The risk is that banning straws may confer what's called a moral license, allowing companies and their customers to feel like they've done their part. The crucial challenge is to ensure that these bans are just a first step, offering a natural place to start with low-hanging fruit, so long as it's part of a much more fundamental shift away from single-use plastics across the value chains of these companies and of our economy." In behavior science, the moral license is often called negative spillover. And it's argued that if you do pro-environmental behavior, it may lead to impacts that are positive, like as a gateway theory, or negative. So let's say you bring your cloth bag to the store, you might then fill it up with imported steaks to spoil yourself because you brought your cloth bags. Or you might drive away in a gas-guzzling Nissan Armada. I don't know, I try to pick something nobody drives in Boulder, but you know, a bad car, right? Something that uses a lot of gasoline, right? So the idea is, they've done studies that people who reuse, and I'm someone who reuses, who brings in cloth bags, were more likely to buy the impulse chocolate at the grocery store counter than people who don't. There are people that their whole life is trying to figure out how to sell us more, like every second before we leave the store, right? And so they've discovered this, yeah? So as I indicated at the beginning of the talk, I also have a whole chapter dedicated to disability critiques of how plastic straw policies did not initially include the voices of those who do need plastic straws to live, and how some individuals took it upon themselves to shame individual people who asked for plastic straws. And I'm happy to elaborate on that. I just wanna say here, that Emmy Kane and the rest of Lonely Whale immediately responded to this critique, set up dialogues and consultation with disabled people, and have since successfully advocated for disability accommodations to single-use plastic bans in places like New York City's plastic ban. My interviews with Emmy and disability justice advocate Mia Ives-Rubley are available on my podcast, Communicating Care. I share this in part because I feel like too often when people characterize polarizing topics or radical critiques, they don't pay attention to or hear about or follow through on the hard work of building coalitions and learning. So Lonely Whale did listen and change its messaging to become more inclusive, which you can tell if you go to their website. And I think that's really actually admirable and noteworthy. Whether it's your jam or not, by most accounts, Lonely Whale's campaign was successful from a media impact perspective. The publicity Lonely Whale generated collectively about single-use plastic pollution through their hashtag marketing is undeniable, provoking positive and negative reactions among a range of publics on and offline. They were able to partner with a government as well as many companies. So they worked with Seattle-based Starbucks, Alaska Airlines, and Dell, who all promised to get rid of plastic straws as a result of this campaign in part. They also had partnerships that moved people then from individuals to systemic changes, right? And also help them avoid some of the criticisms environmentalists often get, like they didn't care about jobs because they were working with companies, yeah? In 2019, Fast Company described Lonely Whale as one of the most innovative companies in the nation, and Lonely Whale Foundation also won Silver Distinction in Social Good Campaign category from the Shorty Awards and a Bronze Effie Award in the Positive Change category. Rather than calling for the public to save the ocean or save the whale or even save ourselves, the self-deprecating humor of the Stop Sucking campaign not only appeals to those who are tired of celebrity culture, especially when elites tell other people what to do, but they also model a different way of acting human. That is, instead of promoting an arrogant perception that we have all the answers and we know what's best, there's a humility performed in claiming one sucks and getting a slow motion tentacle slap that arguably models a different role for humanity. Instead of promoting the hero or the savior complex of humans or celebrities, this mode of engagement embraces self-recognition of harm, being able to laugh at oneself, and just striving to be better. And of course, this movement to increase regulations of plastic is bigger than Lonely Whale or straws. As in the beginning of my talk, single-use bans and calls to increase regulations of plastics began in the Global South and continue to spread farther in the Global South than here in the Global North. Although not the largest part of plastic pollution problems, straws are identified in a growing number of single-use plastic bans as part of our contemporary crises, including in Vanuatu, Taiwan, Bali, Britain, Jamaica, and the EU. Most recently, members of the United Nations met in Nairobi, Kenya in February, and they negotiated a public plastics treaty, which has till 2024 to be passed with legal and financial accountability. So the next couple of years, it's really vital that we have these conversations and we tell representatives, if we support them, why we care about single-use plastics. In conclusion, I hope you enjoyed hearing about the Lonely Whale's advocacy. It's the first time that I've shared this with anyone in public. It's the first time I've ever talked between a volleyball court and a pool. So I'm very excited to hear what your impressions are about how the ocean was portrayed well or not. And I'll just leave this up here and happy to talk about more about what you can do next, because I assume some people want to ask questions about that. But thank you for listening tonight, and I look forward to hearing your questions and comments. The one thing that's not on the slide is Ocean First, actually, if you go to your website, funds microplastic research counting cleanup. So you can also go there and look for that. Are there questions online in the chat or questions from the room, or like people want to share any reactions to these videos? Because I'm obsessed with them and would love to hear just whether people are like, no, that doesn't work, or I think it would turn this off, or yes, this kind of moves me or is interesting, or add other questions.
Yeah. Pretty moving. I like the different, right, like you said, very different heartfelt on this.
Right.
Yeah, we did a, I guess it was like around 2017, Ocean First partnered with NOAA, and
yeah.
We had a, I cannot remember what it's called, we had a group of kids come in and they all had to do a project, and they agreed upon trying to get businesses in Boulder to stop selling single-use straws.
Uh-huh.
And they knew all about the Stop Sucking campaign, like, way more than I did, just because of the world of Instagram or Facebook, whatever, at that point. And the pushback, like, they would go into restaurants, they would have conversations, and the parents would go with them, and they just said the pushback was that everyone they would talk to be like, well, it's not my decision, it's not my decision. And I just think that alludes to you saying, like, it was almost like they were coming off as being shamed, like, oh, we can't do this yet. But they did have a couple people on the Hill, surprisingly,
nice.
That gave them, like, they followed through and talked to their managers and things like that.
Yeah.
But I guess that kind of leads to my question, too, of when we have kids come in here that want to make a difference, and I hear what you're saying about not talking to the individual, but sometimes that's where they need to start.
Oh.
Like, what do you recommend
for
the youth coming in?
Thank you for bringing that up, because that, one, it teaches me more about what you all have been up to, and two, I definitely don't mean don't talk to individuals. I mean don't shame individuals.
Yeah.
So the backlash came when it was actually a lot of servers. So someone would say, I would like a plastic straw at a restaurant, and the server would say, oh, so you don't care about sea turtles. And then the person's been in the position where they either have to divulge their medical history of like why they felt they needed a straw, you know, like in this public space. And that is what kind of rolled into this huge backlash that then Lonely Whale had to respond to, because it seemed like individuals were being shamed for a request, right? But there, so one is, of course, as you maybe where it got into with this campaign is ask first. Policy. So ask first is a way to get around single-use plastics, where you're not automatically given the plastic straw at the table. So even if just like every server in place here didn't automatically put a plastic straw down, but then held it in case someone wanted one, we would reduce so many straws, because how many of us have gotten straws? And like half the time I don't even want the straw, right? It's like not the thing I want to drink out of. I want to drink out of like the nice glass or whatever it is, right? So one is shifting those behaviors. But two, yeah, I think that's a great point. I think this is why we need to talk about it, because you do, you get people who are like, it's not me, or why are you coming to me? Or, you know, oh, kids in Boulder, you know, they're such idealists, just grow up and you'll see how the real world works. Like, I'm okay with that if we're talking about employment and affordable housing. But if we're talking about your need for a plastic straw, unless you have an accommodation, like, really? Like, unless you have, like, why do you need plastic around your lettuce? Why do you need plastic? I mean, I love the three pepper lineup at Trader Joe's, but why is it in plastic every time? And you can't do
all their produce.
All their produce is in plastic, and we love our Trader Joe's, and I still shop there. And I come home, and I'm like, none of this. All of this is going to exist now forever, for hundreds of years. And I'm like,
they tried to stop. They reduced a little bit.
They did reduce a little bit, but I feel like we could go them more. We're like, we're your consumer base, right? And you know, like, you sit there and you're taking out. You're like, pick up the three peppers, or in some places they've started to use banana leaves. I'm sure some of you have traveled, have some cool stories of different types of things people use to gather up produce that isn't plastic film, which is literally like not recycled anywhere and none of us really need it. A lot of the plastic bags like people use, they like carried all their stuff through the store, and then suddenly at the cash register you can't. You know, like suddenly you're like, I carried these three items through Target, and then I get to the cash register, yeah, I better take that bag to get to my car. Why? You're just walking around for whatever amount of time at Target. You could keep walking to the car with it all in your hands, right? Not always, but in some instances, could we do that, right? And the question is, for those of you who love water and marine life, like, you know, you're seeing the impacts. I would love to hear more about the coral reefs. Like, we are seeing this. Do you have an example?
Well,
of that?
I would say one thing, and it was before my time here, but we're a B Corp. So one of the things we do is we challenge ourselves to challenge our partners.
Yeah.
And I think it was Kathy G or somebody in the shop, in the retail shop, took all of the packaging and like stacked it
like trash fish.
Yeah. And then took pictures and sent it to Aqualung, and we were like, what can you do to send us your equipment, but reduce the packaging that you're sending us? And they did, yeah. And that was something we did. That's like why I clearly have a lot of questions about use. Is because we would take the plastic from them and then take it into our marine science classes and use that for a craft, so at least it had a second life.
Sure.
But yeah, the youth would come in and they would be the ones creating these ideas. Like, we made trash fish and things like that and sent it to Aqualung. So that's why I'm just like, how do we inspire them? Like, let's say, I mean, we are lucky in Boulder that most of the time their parents can help, but let's say they can't. How do we get those youth involved in making the decisions when it's supposed to be at a more organizational or political level?
Yeah, I love that. I mean, so to me, I don't know if people caught in that last, second to last video, Shutez Martinez was in it, who grew up in Boulder. Do people know him? I'll pull up his picture just so people, he grew up here in Boulder and has spoken in front of the UN like—
Oh, the Guardians.
Yeah, the Earth Guardians. Mm-hmm. Spoke in front of the UN, I don't know, like twice by the time he was 17. And he talked about on the Trevor Noah Show, like the first action he did was with a bunch of, I think it was either fourth or fifth graders, and they like bum rushed this politician, and sorry, everything wants to come up while I'm here. I don't know why Amazon wants to come up. I don't want his book. Well, that was his book. He does have a book. I don't mean to be showing you products. I'm just trying to show you his picture, but it just really wants me to sell you something here. Let me go down here. So if you've been, you know, he went to Boulder High, like some of you might know him. He was the like front face for Earth Guardians here in Boulder for a while. So we actually do have a track record of youth making a difference here in Colorado and elsewhere. Milo Kress was a youth when he started his Be Free Straw campaign. Do people know? So this 500 million straws a day in the United States, quote, comes from actually someone who was under the age of 18, and he was doing a report and he was trying to calculate it, and he started calling all the companies, like, how many do you sell? How many are being used? How many are being bought? Like, trying to figure it out. So that statistic actually comes from him, which is just really revealing about our world and how much we don't keep track of plastic anymore. We just kind of use it all the time. And so nobody actually, I mean, there is no better, there's no great statistic on how many straws we use a day. And everyone uses Milo's study, which was literally a kid calling up on the phone to companies, how many straws are you selling? And then he tried to make an estimate from there. And even he's like, I don't know if it's, why do people keep quoting this? He still does great work, but he's like, I was a kid and, you know, it was my best guess at the time, but it is certainly a lot and they're rarely recycled. So one, I would say from the climate movement and other examples in Colorado, our youth do make a huge difference. Like they do actually, I know there's a lot of states in the United States right now who don't really like children, but I'd say in Colorado, we actually are like, oh, they motivate us. They carry some moral weight, you know? So I feel like I can say this here. I don't know if there are people online from other states, and then I'm sorry about that because that's really, that's hard. A lot of states, it's hard right now for youth. But two, I would channel them into exactly what you did, which I love, right? Connecting them with science, right? So a lot of the kids who care about plastics don't necessarily know, especially like young females don't necessarily know they can become a scientist, right? Can go into marine biology, can go scuba diving, right? Like too often. Now we're shifting that representation globally, but to show them examples of, well, you really care about plastics, why? Because you care about fish, why? Well, if you care about fish, you should care about coral reefs. Let us show this cool coral reef product. You know, like doing that systems thinking for them, like they'll get excited about something because they're, to kids, it's obvious. They're like, no, I don't need a plastic bag. Like, I don't even, why are we killing ourselves and all of our scuba experiences in the future for a plastic bag? Like that is not the hill you want to die on, right? Like it can't really be what you want to ruin that experience over, right? So I feel like they get that. But for you, with the work you're doing, that's why I think it's so incredible what you're doing, because you're connecting them with all these other ways to think about it, right? There are some plastics that can be reused. We're very, in Boulder, we're incredibly lucky. Colorado has passed a plastic ban that's going to go into effect about bags. Yeah, and we have a fee about plastic bags and paper bags here in Boulder that some of you have probably experienced and know about. And in Colorado, we have EcoCycle here in Boulder, which does a lot more than most places. So I am cautious with this talk because there's a lot of places where you can't recycle hardly any plastics. Like you really, most places you can only really recycle one or two. So that's the other thing we know now, yeah? So the cascading arrows is greenwashing. The cascading arrows were made in 1970 by a student because a manufacturing company put up a contest the first Earth Day in 1970 and said, give us a symbol for the idea that plastics go into an infinity. And this student loved M.C. Escher. I don't know if people know that like artist who draws like weird stairwells that are kind of like surreal and so forth. And was like, oh, let me do like an M.C. Escher, like arrows keep going image. There is no law or regulation connected to those cascading arrows. But most of us are told from a very young age that cascading arrows are a symbol of recyclability. But there's literally nowhere where you can recycle number six plastics. Is that a thing? So the numbers are manufacturing codes of the type of plastic. But we associate the arrows to think, well, if I was just better, I would find the place where I could recycle or reuse this form of plastic. That's why it can't be left to the individuals because they're not recyclable, right? There's this great term that some of the folks in plastics advocacy use or anti-plastic pollution use that it's called wish cycling. And most of us like good-hearted people have done this in our lives. Like you've had takeout or whatever it is and you stand over your recycling bin and you're like, is this recyclable or not? I mean, like I do it. And I've been like looking at plastic research for like years now. And I'm like, and I'll ask my partner. I'm like, is that? And he's like, no, here's the chart again. And I'm like, I know, but I have to like look through this whole novel to remember what can we use. And I have some neighbors. There's a new pickup plastic program we have in here in Boulder. And we have a new app called Repeater. Has anyone used Repeater? So Repeater is a push to use reusable to-go containers. And one of my goals for this next year is to try to convince Alloy Tie to do it. Because I don't know about you in the pandemic, but Alloy Tie has a special place in my heart. It's like, that's how I got through the pandemic. Oh, I was like, yeah, take out. To get them, yes. So to say, don't use plastic clamshells. Don't use these single-use plastics. These are repeatables. And then you can drop them off and they can be used again. I'm made the mistake the first time I used it at Rincon Argentina, and that was so stupid because they put their empanadas in like pizza cardboard containers. And so it was like, well, that's not really like the worst thing that's happening in our world right now is like cardboard pizza containers, yeah? So, but in here in Boulder in Colorado, we have a lot of options. And if they could show support, kids telling their parents, yes, we care about this. Why do we have so much plastic waste? When you go to get your takeout, to be like, I don't need all the utensils. Like, don't automatically give everyone silverware and chopsticks every time they get takeout. Because a lot of times with the pandemic, we're just getting the takeout to go home. We're not like actually going to a park. Sometimes we are, but then we usually have like really cool like kitchen kits we want to use because we bought them at REI and we want to go like use them outside. So anything like that, I love your ideas. Like, I think it matters for them to see that systemic change. I think what you did matters. And maybe the first year it doesn't work, but then the second year, they're like, oh, those kids came back.
Yeah, they did ask me if they were able to do that.
I love that.
Like, well, that's the thing with
you,
like, ask me before giving. Like,
yeah.
I'm sure it's all in the stickers or some kind of plastic.
To advertising. I know, here's our irony, right? But that's okay. I mean, that's why I always also want to start off with, like, confessing about my plastic use, because none of us are going to get to a point where, like, tomorrow, the Just Transition Alliance does this, they call with their interns, it's like a romance story. And there's this the woman, Susan Frankel, who wrote a book about this, too, where they're like, try to go 1 hour without touching plastic. Like, we can't do it, you know? And it's a fun, you can try it with youth to be like, see how long you can make it without, yeah. So you can't touch your phone, you can't touch your computer, can't touch contact glass, you know? And then you start to, like, can I go in my kitchen? Well, I can't touch that, I could touch that. And I'm someone who, like, in my home, I feel like I don't have a lot of plastic stuff. Like, I love wood and stone and, you know, those types of materials. And yet, if you look around, you'll find all this plastic in your life, right? We're not going to get to a place where people are going to say tomorrow or next week or in a year, let's get rid of all the plastic. But this single-use plastic is stuff we're using really quickly and then disposing of, and it's hundreds of years, and it's made from fossil fuels, which are contributing to climate change. So all these things are things that say, well, can we do this work? Can we, okay, the youth care. The youth are like, why are we doing this? And we kind of just got used to it, just kind of seeped into our lives. I don't know if people looked at themselves on that timeline, like when you were born and what was made then and how it's just kind of built up over time. It's not just you, like it actually, it's exploding right now. Do other people have stories to share, questions online? I can't see the chat, but we have someone here.
We have feedback online, we don't have questions. Stephanie. Stevie Gordon says, no questions, but what a wonderful presentation.
Oh, thanks you.
We have another one, an amazing presentation, such powerful images and video clips. Thank you for sharing this with us. Amazing presentation, such amazing messaging. Thank you for bringing this information to us and to sharing. And then they had asked me to repeat some of the questions.
Oh, yeah, I should repeat questions when they ask them, when people ask them.
Yeah, and then a lot of thank
yous. Oh, that's awesome. Thank you.
Really good feedback.
Yeah, I mean, I'm with Ken. I feel like you all already care about oceans. You love your time in the ocean already. So, like, we're over one big, huge question together because we're in this landlocked state. There's a lot of people who are like, why are we talking about that? Why aren't you talking about wildfires? Which is, you know, I can make the connection from plastic to anything. But here, I feel like you're already on board. But I am excited to hear. Yeah.
I was just going to say, like, our nonprofit Ocean First Institute has been doing a lot of testing along the front range for microplastics. And it's incredible what they're finding. It's sad, you know, because the truth is it's in our landlocked state and it's all going to the ocean. And so I'm proud and excited for them to kind of, you know, continue on this project of, I mean, they're inspiring youth, so it's middle school kids who are helping them get the samples in the river and then bring them back and test them and show how much microplastics are actually in Colorado and all of it's leading, you know, to the ocean. So really trying to gain some more corporate donors and figure out what we can do to make a larger impact around everything. So
I love that.
Yeah, I know. It's, yeah, I feel like people don't always think about it as an inland state, you know, that like, yes, everything we're doing here is going to the ocean.
Yes.
So I feel like it's giving a different feel to what we're finding here.
Yeah, exactly. That's that systems thing, you know, connecting people that everything here does go to the ocean, right? This is the group. So for folks online, Ocean First, you should check out their website. They do fund microplastic tracking, like it's called like a citizen science program. They were just saying that they work with middle schoolers or youth also to do this. And this is the research that just in the past year came out that they found microplastics in Estes Park, in Rocky Mountain National Park, right? So we can identify it now in our rainwater, in our snow, in our ice melt, into our rivers and streams, into our drinking supply, into our bodies, into our blood, our air, and out into the ocean, right? And so anything that can track that to make that case to remind people, and then to think about, well, what does that mean for us, right? And then why might we make a little bit more effort to think about ways we could innovate and stop it? So there are companies that try to think about what you can reuse plastic for, like benches. And I showed a picture of a record album. So Lonely Whale, their next campaign was to try to get to sponsor people, The Future Doesn't Suck, and to try to think about ways to, I know, well, you got a good thing, you got to run with it.
Yeah.
How do you like make, that's actually like a record album out of these microbeads, like what else can you do with it? But I also, James Wakibia, who is one of the photographers from Kenya in my slides, you know, he shared pictures with me where he's like reading like plastic manifests and showing me plastic packaging that's supposed to be going to recycling. And all we're really doing is just shipping it somewhere else. Like we pay someone, like in Boulder, we pay people, I don't know if everyone online is from Boulder, but we pay people to take away our waste and our recycling. We're like, oh good, we also get to compost. I feel very lucky here, right? And then the question was, where does it go? So there was actually this great journalist in the UK who put trackers in two plastic recycling bins in the UK this spring, and then followed where those recycling bins went. And they went all over the world and they just ended up in a dump, right? And so again, EcoCycle is better. I say that because the former mayor runs EcoCycle and she's a very lovely woman. I like Suzanne Jones very much, but there are other places where I'm sure many people are coming from where the plastics aren't necessarily going someplace useful, and it's not what our intent is. So it's good to track them, right? Where do they go? How does that make us? And then mostly, like, how do you get people to care,
yeah,
right? Because if we just talk about the problems, we're not reminding people of, like, what we love, you know? And I think, like, these images, the oceans and the whale songs, it's breathtaking. At that point, the whale songs in the mid-20th century was the most sold album ever in history. That's pretty incredible when you think about it.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm sure like BTS has way surpassed them by now because K-pop is like all other levels of popularity I don't fully understand. But in the mid-20th century, like it was whale songs that blew everybody's minds. That everyone's like, it was an insert in National Geographic. They gave a free record in the back of the magazine of whale songs. And the world was like, what? I mean, we take that for granted now, but back in the day, like we didn't know whales sung. And you saw the video, like it does look like a social network. And then you think about ships and how that might be interfering with how they communicate with each other. So like trying to remember, given that marvel, Rachel Carson is such a beautiful writer because she talked about the wonder. Like what's the wonder in the world? And that's why youth are awesome because they're not like cynical yet. And they're like, oh, I still find something amazing. And you're like, you get to show them for the first time something. And they're like, eyes pop up and it's like, great. I teach college students because I just like to work with cynical people. I'm like, I want to talk about cancer and toxics and plastic. So can you handle it without crying? And they're like, we're on board. But youth are really great for that. So hopefully we will find networks, we'll find innovation here in Boulder. If we could find companies that were willing to fund some of these projects that Ocean First does, mm-hmm, to track it, to promote education, to get the next generation up on board. This is happening in a very short time, both climate policy and plastics policy. We got this short window and people are moving quickly. So it's good to be on board and try to do whatever you can.
Yeah. Do you give presentations all around the US?
Yeah, and in China. And I was invited to two places in China in the first year. And I'm like, I don't know anything about China. This is great. Because this was before pandemic, right before the pandemic. As an environmentalist, to me, China was always presented as like the boogeyman of the environment, right? It was like, oh, we're bad, but China's worse. And I was like, what? Like, is that true? Right, because they're taking our trash. That's what we find out, right? They have so much plastic because it's our 70% of our plastic that they were taking. I'm like, what? I'm not saying there aren't problems. It's I co-edited a book with someone who's Muslim in China, and there's a lot of issues in China as there are in any country in the world. But it was amazing to go there because at the time, 45 was our president, and President Xi picked up every policy Trump dropped. He was like, I'll make all the next solar panels. Like, if you don't want to be part of the next energy revolution, China does. We'll make solar panels, we'll do these other things. So it was interesting to be there because like the US, it's complicated. There's great people doing amazing stuff and other people, but no, this is my first volleyball court swimming pool combo, but I love talking to people.
Yeah. I just think that I'm from North Carolina. It's just like so different. Like even the beach areas, when I go home and I go to the beach, they paper bags are unheard of. I travel with my own bag and it's like shocking to them.
Yeah.
And they live on the beach.
Yeah.
So it's a big thing with poverty and things like that and access.
Yes.
And so
yes.
It's not that people don't care, but if they don't have the money to pay 10 cents and things like that, like
right.
Add up and I just think about meeting that middle. How do we get people on board, but also how to recognize that like they shouldn't have to pay for that.
Yeah, I got my PhD at UNC. That's where I picked up y'all. It's one of my favorite
words.
And that's when I stopped saying banana, because all my Southern students would totally be like, Yankee, what are you doing teaching me? So I tried to get rid of all my Yankee accent there. Those are amazing communities. This is why the coastal communities like that. You're like, how could we? Well, could we? I mean, I have like 50 canvas bags, because like every conference I go to, they gave me canvas bags for you. Does some of you have?
Oh, yeah.
I'm like, could we set up a system where we partnered with coastal towns around the world and we were like, we'll send you and do a canvas bag drive here in Boulder. I bet you'd have like 1,000 canvas bags that people are like, I'm doing spring cleaning. I really don't use 100%. These 10 from these conferences or whatever. And then just give them to people for free. Like that would be an amazing program. I would love to be involved in something like that where we just partnered up with coastal communities.
We
like,
have them.
There we go. See? They're gorgeous. Oh, look at this plot. Wait, see? People could either buy the Ocean First by people online or being deprived of this gorgeous canvas bag with a coastal reef and a beautiful blue color.
Wine inserts, people.
Oh my gosh, stop. This is really
magical. This is
see,
for
you. You don't
want
to give away. Oh, stop. You
yes.
don't want to give away that bag. But
well,
you have other bags that are less cool with less compartments that you would give away. That's the sort of thing we could do very easily, right?
Yeah.
We could do that. Or every scuba trip. Yeah. What if every scuba trip you were like, people, give your friends bags when they go on the scuba trip.
We do that
with
on
you.
Our trips. We
love
give
it.
Them
and then
a
give them
beautiful
away.
Bag that you get that exact bag. Mixed
this
with
is
some
a nice
of our
bag.
Really fun branded merch.
Yeah,
items.
I won't give this to anyone because you have all the, I love pockets.
Yeah. It's really nice for
such
a
good thing.
yeah.
So how can we do that? Right?
Because
then there are people here in Boulder where we're like, well, I don't want to get rid of all these bags because what do I do with a canvas bag? But what if we made partnerships like that? But some of the plastic things really do. I know a lot of people, some things do cost more, but some things, no.
Yeah.
It's just habit, you know? So I remember like, you know, a couple decades ago when I was getting my PhD, like at UNC with my water bottle, the students would look at me like, I'm like, I don't know.
And they're actually like kind of on it there.
Now they are.
Yeah.
Now they're like, yeah.
But
you know,
compared
it's the progressive
to like
bubble, yes. It's true. But now I have the water bottle in my hand. Like, voice is like, why are you not drinking? But even just modeling, like, oh, well, where do I put it? You know, where do you carry it? How do you use it? It can shift. That's the nudging behavior. Yeah. So yeah, I love that idea. We should let me get an excuse to like go to the Outer Banks.
Okay.
It's gorgeous.
I love it. I don't think they're impoverished.
No, they're not impoverished. But I bet they would partner.
Yes.
I mean, we see it in QR Go where we're opening up our dive shop.
Yeah.
The keys, like, I mean, single-use
plastic
everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, you had Jason
Mamola.
Mamola is how you pronounce it.
She knows that.
Large
fan. Yeah. He's doing, like, the aluminum can water bottles, which is, like,
yes. Yes.
And it's kind of like giving that fixation of maybe having that plastic bottle because, I mean, I know people from Pennsylvania. I know a lot of people in Pennsylvania still using the buying, you know, the big things of the plastic water bottles. And it's just like a habit. And it's in, like, you know, the keys, I noticed it a lot when I went down.
Yeah.
And so
they're everywhere.
I think just trying to nudge, like you said, and be like,
I think
you
can like
show
an example.
Yeah.
Like you do.
Exactly.
Yeah.
and kind of at our dive shop, we're like, okay, well, we're just going to get one of those huge refillable water coolers and then compostable cups.
And make it available, right? So if you also lower the barrier to the change.
Yeah. Yep.
So what is it that's making it harder, right? Like, how do we think about, oh, it's because they didn't think they would have a place to refill, so they thought they had a bring, or what is it that's stopping? And that's when you have to talk to people one-on-one.
Yeah.
You're like, well, why aren't you? Like, instead of accusing people, don't shame people, but say, like, oh, so why is that your thing? And some people have interesting answers, right? Some people have answers you're like, okay, you should use that. And then other people you're like, oh, well, did you know you could do that with a water bottle? You know, you could just take a bag. You know, you can get bags that roll up really tiny, so they don't take a lot of space on you if you're worried about when you're hiking or something like that, right? But sometimes you just don't know the gadgets or think differently, you know? Are there other people, other questions? Otherwise, we can just hang out at this, like, fun. There's a whole reception here. I need to stand between people and wine, especially when we're about to have a snowstorm. Anything else online that I have to be aware of? Okay, great. Good. Well, thank you all. Go ahead, please.
I'm just curious. So if we go to that website, Conservation International.
Yes.
Are some of those videos available?
Yes. Yes. And they're super fun. Do you work with, I don't know.
Yeah, we could probably share them as well. Yes. Like on the Facebook event, if you would feel that useful, we can give a copy of the presentation. So we can put
I'll
share those out so you can see them. Yeah.
They are,
I agree. I would
open to it. Make sure it doesn't.
Yeah, we'll share the whole recording, of course.
And so you'll find that they have Julia Roberts's Mother Nature. That's my most polarizing video. There's some people who really don't like Julia Roberts. They have very strong feelings. I keep expecting Julia Roberts's Mother Nature. I know it's like hard. You're like, really? That was your cast. You know, I think it was the Aaron Brockovich moment. I don't know. She's a big name. Yeah. But no, my students do not enjoy that. One of my favorite ones is actually Ed Norton is Dirt. It's so good. And it's all about how we don't give a dirt, or we don't pay attention to soil and how important it is for all life. And we just treat him like dirt. And it's a pretty good one.
So we'll post the recording of this whole presentation on our YouTube channel, and then we'll include all the links to the videos in there. Yeah. So we'll get that up in the next, probably next week, early next week.
Yeah.
All right. Let you guys know in the group for sure.
Okay. Yeah, please share the videos. And like I said, the digital marketing strategist is, you know, went to CU Boulder and, you know, comes through every once in a while. So if people are interested, she would be super fun. She's really interesting. They're doing great work. If you would want her to come through or something like that at some point.
You should definitely introduce Ingrid to her so that Ingrid can stalk her.
That's what I said to Ingrid when I saw Ingrid ahead of time. Ingrid, if you're still online, I said, you have to meet her because I think you'd really enjoy Emmy and do the digital marketing together because there's a lot of great connections.
We're friends for life now, so.
Okay, perfect. I love it. Well, thank you, everyone. I don't want to stall you. I appreciate you coming out and thank you for coming online, and I'll stick around in case people have questions.
Thank you.